at 2:01 on August 8th. Planned Parenthood and the ACLU are working to legalize abortion up until birth without parental consent in Ohio. Stand for life and vote yes on issue 1 on Tuesday, August 8th to protect our Constitution from Planned Parenthood and the ACLU's deadly agenda. Issue 1 alleviates the threshold to amend our state constitution to 60% of the vote. It makes it more difficult for out-of-state special interests to manipulate our elections. This better protects Ohio from having unrestricted abortion up until birth. So, please vote yes on issue 1 on August 8th. If you need any further information, contact the office. We have information that they've been sending to the church, and I believe next week, Pastor is going to try to play a video that our state bishop sent, you know, to just further inform us on this issue 1. My next announcement is August 6th, we are having Membership Sunday. If you are interested in joining this awesome church and becoming an official member, please call our church office. It is on the screen. You're not going to look back there, are you? This screen. Call our church office. Let us know. Talk to Pastor Bynum and let us know that you would like to join our church. Okay, I have an announcement for Team Men, but Kayla's going to come up and do an announcement leading up to Team Men Water Day. Where's the bucket of water we're going to throw on her? Right?
It's been really hot. So August 6th, coming up after church, all the teenagers are going to stay after church, and we're going to have some lunch together, and I have over 1,000 water balloons. I believe the official count might be closer to 1,400 or 1,500. Whoa. I'm like super excited. Like, so excited. We're going to play Angry Birds. We're going to play all kinds of stuff. If you have teenagers, if you know teenagers, if you have a large enough van and you want to just drive down the street and pick them up and throw them in, don't get caught. More power to you. But that's going to come up on August 6th, and we are going to stay here and hang out until 3 p.m. You're a parent of a teenager and you don't want the time off to go get lunch or something, you can feel free to stay and watch, and hopefully you don't get a wound in the face. I can't control these people. But if you're a teenager, if you have teenagers, if you know teenagers, this is a great, hi Sunny, this is a great time to bring them out and let them play with water balloons. So August 6th.
Yeah, I was going to say, save money on family therapy and save for a water day and just throw water balloons at your teen's face. You know, do that. My next announcement here, next Sunday, we are having a I'm Ready Connect lunch for new attenders. That's after church next Sunday. Once again, call the church office if you plan to attend, so that way they can plan the food accordingly. Okay, through the month of July and August, on Wednesday evening, starting July 12th, Pastor Ron and Noah Searles are sharing a dynamic teaching series using the book by Malcolm Smith, The Power of the Blood Covenant. So that is for our adult Bible studies through July and August. And
Praise the Lord. Oh, let there be noise in the house. Amen, amen. Come on, isn't it good to be in the house of the Lord today? Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. As we get into our worship, I want to share a little bit of testimony this morning. Some things that's been going on this week. I don't know what's been going on in your week, but I got some good things to share this week. I've got some good things to share. This past week, over at a, oh, come on, we still fellowship. That's okay. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Listen, this is a good problem to have. It's a good problem to have when your church likes each other. Amen. Yeah, it's a good problem to have. Good problem to have. All right, y'all. All right. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. I'm just going to go. But now, listen. So this past week, I was preaching a church camp at Rio. And first off, praise the Lord for how many people we had there. They had like 80 kids there, which was awesome. And it wasn't under a collective church name. It was kind of interesting. It was just like a community thing where a few churches got together and sent these kids to camp. And man, some of them had some rough stories to share, but the Lord had wrapped them up this past week. And we had 25 of them accept Jesus as their Lord and Savior. Praise the Lord. It was awesome, man. The Spirit of God moved. And even more so, I gotta share this too, because last night was our last service, and as we got to the prayer time, and kids would come up, and so many of them were praying at the altar. It wasn't a church camp that was broadcast as a Pentecostal church camp, y'all. It wasn't named anything, but two of them were filled with the Holy Ghost with evidence and speaking in tongues last night at the altar. And the Lord is still moving, and there's power in the Holy Ghost. Amen. And he's still filling, and I believe he's filling this next generation. We've got a lot to praise him for. No matter our circumstances, no matter the mountaintop or valley, he is still God, and he deserves to be praised. So right now, whatever's been going on in your week, let's begin to lift up hands and praise him right now. Lord, we come to you in humble hearts, Lord, to lift up your holy name, to exalt you, Father, above all else. And God, as we lift your name, you will draw them in, Father. We lean upon your promises. We lean upon your understanding and your ways, God, for they are higher than ours. And Lord, fill this place today. Fill our hearts, God. Those that need you and your comfort, comfort them. Those that need healing, heal them, Father. Those that need saving, save them. Fill this place, God, and have your way. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. Come on, let's go ahead and just begin to praise him. Say hallelujah. start, because it is a celebration. But I want to say this right now, because the Lord put this word on my heart. Just as Joshua and Israel was marching around those walls of Jericho, you know, it's something that the walls did not fall down instantly, but yet they walked around them for 7 days. I want to tell somebody today to keep walking around Jericho. That the Lord is still working. And it's in that waiting. It's in that waiting. He says that those who wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength. They'll soar high on the wings like eagles. They will run and not grow weary. They will walk and not faint. So church, keep walking. Keep walking. You've got to get to the promised land, but sometimes the Lord ain't working on the land. He's working on you. He's getting you ready. So keep walking, keep walking, keep walking. Father, we worship you.
demoniac of Gadara. You know, when when Jesus came, it was necessary that he go that way. And he stepped into a place that was very far from God. And there was this guy that was demon-possessed. And they tried to contain him, and the town couldn't do it. And they put him out there in the among the graves and the tombs. He was so demon-possessed, he ran around naked. When Jesus showed up on that shore and walked toward that area, that man saw him, the demon saw him, and the Bible says he raced, he rushed at him. Going, come on him. This wasn't an ordinary man that was standing there. It was Jesus. And the demons had to recognize the superiority of Jesus. And they said, did you come? He says, what's your name? He said, we are legion, for we're many. And that's just like the devil. He wants to make us think that we're outnumbered. Oh, I tell you, walk with God, the math changes with God. I'm telling you, the devil tries to add, but then God comes on the scene and he multiplies. And so he multiplies. And so he said, have you come here to torment us, the demons? Because he's son of God. And he told him, he just simply told them to go. And they went, and there were some people tending some swine on the hillside, some pigs. And they went into the pigs went crazy, and they went and drowned themselves. And the people were taking care of the pigs, took off running toward town, because it scared them what was going on. So when they finally got their composure and they began to come back to where Jesus was, they came back with some others, and there when they came back, they saw something they didn't expect. They saw this man fully clothed and at the feet of Jesus. See, when we lay things at the feet of Jesus, when we lay ourselves at the feet of Jesus, then the Lord can do mighty and great things for us. Whenever we try to do things on our own and handle things on our own, then our pride gets in the way and we usually end up, in the Christian terms, fail. We fail because we're dominated more by the flesh rather than by the Spirit. But when we get at the feet of Jesus, then the Holy Spirit can do a great work in us and with us, and we'll be a testimony to the people around us of look what God can do. Noah started on the Hebrew children, not the nation of Israel, marching around Jericho. Do you know what God was really saying at that moment? He was saying, listen, you march around that city. Don't say a word while everybody else is yelling at you and making fun of you for so many days marching around the city. He said, then you march around it, and when you reach the seventh time, the Bible says that God told them to give a shout. I got to tell you, you can go and stand at that wall and shout as much as you want, but nothing's going to happen. Your voice, the vocal cords, you'll lose your voice trying to shout to make a wall come down. God was trying to show the people there in Jericho that it wasn't going to be by an army. And even the army was probably getting tired of marching. And it wasn't going to be by some voice, a shout, an intimidation. But literally, it was going to be by the mighty hand of God. And sometimes we want to try and shout it to happen. Maybe get mad and are yelling. But it will take God and God alone for something to really happen and the walls to come down in your life for you to receive the victory. So it's God, isn't it? Let go and let God. That's what it is. Let go and let God. Let God begin to do things in your life. Yeah, because he's the one that does it all. He's the one we bow at his feet. And we find the transformation through him alone. I believe the church world will get it in many. get it right to the fact that we can't have concerts that are going to bring the glory of God down. We can't have the great thrills and thrills of everything to really have a move of God. It's going to be a people who will bow at the feet of Jesus and allow Him to do what He wants to do. That's the only way anything supernatural is going to happen. So I say keep singing, keep praising the Lord. But you make sure that you know it's God who's going to do the work. It is God who does the work every time. And you may be tired walking around those walls. And so much of you don't think you've got much shout left in you. Well, God's trying to show you that it's not going to be by your emotions or anything you do. It's going to be everything He does. And that you put your faith in Him. I believe I'm talking to some mature Christians right now. That we need to submit ourselves unto God. Resist the devil, then he'll flee from you. That we submit ourselves unto God. Resist the devil, and he'll flee from you. So therefore, I tell you what, we serve a great God, don't we? Isn't it wonderful to worship our God that has created the mighty things in our lives? Has God ever done anything for a long time? Father, that you just anoint us. I just pray, God, that you bless this offering. Receive it as worship to you. To bring glory and honor to you, Lord. For that's exactly what we want to do. In Jesus' name. Would you lift your right hand up? I want to pray a blessing over you. The Lord bless you and give you increase. The Lord prosper you in everything you do and everything you touch. The Lord give you above and beyond just necessity, but be blessed so much that those around you will declare and ask, what has happened? And that you may say, it is the Lord that has given me favor and blessing. Be blessed of the Lord. In Jesus' name, amen.
You are there, me now, in the waiting.
Yeah. just thank the Lord for what God's doing. I thank God how the Lord's working in different ministries at the church. I had the opportunity to I didn't crash the gathering, but I wanted to say hello. And yesterday I stepped into the fellowship hall, and there was the important, one of the most important ministries of the church was having a meeting, and it was the nursery group, the team working the nursery, and they just all together planning, putting in strategy. Let me tell you, every ministry at this church, most all of them is team-oriented, and every ministry in this church could use you to volunteer and join in. We've chosen 2023 as Find Your Why, being our focus and vision for this year. Find your why. Find your ministry purpose. There's opportunities in KidMen for the, and KidMen is more than kid fun time, it's kid discipleship time. We have got to disciple our youth. We've got to disciple them, teach them the Word of God, our children, our teens. Though they're great people who volunteer, great teams working toward family ministry, but there's always opportunities. Opportunities. So you can step in and be a part of it. And I want to encourage you to be willing to do that, because we need folks, more folks to be involved. How many of you believe that God's going to take us to the next level? How many here believe God's going to take us to the next level? I'm not going to ask you to show you lift your hand or not, you're just happy the way things are. Because you and I should never be happy the way things are when we go outside and we see a world that's just filled with sin and people who are trapped and bound. And families who don't know Jesus Christ as their personal Savior. Jesus doesn't live in their house. We can never be content and settled. God has called us to reach the lost, to reach the harvest. He's called us to disciple, so disciples will make more disciples. That's how we'll overcome this present age. It will not be solved politically, because there is a seed of sin within our society, and if no political party is going to be able to pull it out. We've gone far and far, and I believe we're going to go further. But with God comes salvation and redemption. With God comes revival and a move of God's presence. Where would you be if it were not for Jesus in your life? I want to encourage you to join and jump aboard doing the ministry and fulfilling that calling in your life to be used of the Lord, because God's raising up generations. Raising them. You know what? Either God raised them up or they're just going to grow up. Did you know that? We can raise up that generation, or we can just watch them grow up. And no matter what's going to happen then, we just watch them grow up. So I just want to challenge you this morning. I tell you, I peeked in that room and seen those kids, and that's my kind of crowd. Babies up, everybody look. Don't raise your hand. I know nobody would raise your hand and say you don't like babies. I'll pray for you. I will pray for you. You don't like babies. They're God's blessing. It's a life of the church life. Just thank God for the nursery team. And even today, I'm working the children so some of the parents can be in the sanctuary today. Let Robbie Pike Church of God be a place where families are ministered to. I thank God. So how are you doing? You doing great? Yeah. How many of you doing great? Raise your hand. Way back. Glory to God. You're looking pretty good. You got a good tan. Some of you come back from vacay and look at you now. You've got all this tan bronze and somewhere away. And some of you just been cutting grass. But you're looking good. Been looking good. Ain't been to the beach. Just been on the mower. But thank God for his blessing and his goodness. I'd like to share a little bit more this morning on Find Your Why. It's just simply we have to consider these questions. We've thought about it this year. We've been pondering on it. And I just want to bring back a remembrance and a resurgence this year find your why. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, in the name of Jesus Christ, I can't do anything. Only you can do what is productive and good and fruitful. Lord, let me speak the words that are from you, anointed by the Holy Ghost. Let each and every one of us receive something today. Holy Spirit, inspire us. And Lord, do something within us. We open ourselves to you, Lord. And we yield ourselves to your presence. Bless this word. Let this word come alive and help the speaker, God, that I might be able to share what you want me to say, Father. In the name of Jesus Christ, amen. Amen. Find your why. And you know the why is these questions such as, why do you do what you do? Why do you do what you do? Why are you here this morning? Why do you do the job you do? Why do you spend time the way you do? What's your why? What's your reason behind how you're living? Have you ever seen an early development child when they're at the stage of life where that, my goodness, all they do is ask why? Why? Why do you do this? Why do we go there? Why do we? Why? Why is this green? Why is it black? Why is it? Why? And why? And why? And then that early development stage, they just keep on asking why for so many things. That's a good instinct that we lose as we get older. But I think it's healthy for us to constantly ask ourselves, why? Why am I doing what I'm doing? Let me ask you this morning, what is your why? What's your reason for what you're doing with your life? And this year, this church, we've declared it as the word of God to us in our hearts, is to find your why. We send out the challenge to everyone around us. Some of you have t-shirts, some of you have the stickers or things to remind that people see it, and it just says, find your why. I want us to look into a man who found his why. I want us to look into the Word of God in Scripture by example that probably will not be a stranger to you who have been a Christian, you who have been a Christian for a while, and no doubt heard some of this account, but I want to look into this man who had found his why. And you know, it's interesting how that, as we observe this man named Nehemiah, who found his why, I find it's very interesting that a person who finds their why end up being a great leader. A person who finds their why ends up being a great leader. Let me tell you what a great leader is in spiritual terms and in the biblical worldview, not like the world is, but what the Bible, what God's looking for. I'll tell you that a great leader is not always the one who gets the publicity, but it's someone who leads others to do something great. They're the great leader. They don't have to get the accolades of recognition. They don't have to be seen. But they're a leader in their life, and they found the why, and others follow, and they end up becoming leaders doing great things. I want to be that kind of leader that others will do great things. If I'm just trying to do great things myself, then it's just me. But if there are others that I'm leading and they do great things, there's many things that can be done. And then it can become contagious where everyone in God's kingdom does great things, what God could do in this world. Now, I'd like to look into the background of Nehemiah. We know in Scripture in the first chapter, Nehemiah, he's the cupbearer to the king Artaxerxes, the king of Persia. In chapter 1, Nehemiah receives a word about his... Now, let me back up here. A cupbearer is pretty serious business with the king. He's a wine taster. He's the guinea pig. He drinks before the king drinks. So if there's poison in it, he dies before the king. So it's serious business of that culture in that time, is that he was guarding the king by being the cupbearer to the king. And not everybody can bring a cup to the king. Only the trusted one. In relationship, you can trust. Now let's face it. If you're not really popular with everybody, and maybe there are some folks who really hate you, wouldn't you really want the trusted person in your life to be your cupbearer? I don't know if I'd want Noah to be my cupbearer. I wouldn't want Noah to die, but if I want to live, I'd get Noah to do that. Thank you, Noah. I appreciate that. I know you'd do that for me, right? But here's Nehemiah, the cupbearer, and he bears the king, the cup that goes to the king, and what the king drinks, what he receives. But Nehemiah receives word from home where he was from. He was a Jewish man. And he heard in his homeland, Israel, the condition of Israel, and especially the capital city, the main city, Jerusalem, the holy city. There the walls have been torn down by the enemy and the gates have been burned up. And that these attacking armies had destroyed those walls and gates, and there's Jerusalem sitting there with torn down walls and burned down the gates of the city. The Bible says Nehemiah's heart was crushed over the news. Then he goes on a fast and prays for Jerusalem. When he does that in the fast, his king starts noticing that something, he knew him enough, he knew something was wrong. Something was weighing him down, something that was affecting him. So that the king asked, what's going on? What's wrong with you, Nehemiah? Nehemiah begins to share. And then God begins to move in the process of it. Notice that Nehemiah felt the need and had a burden way before he ever did anything. See, this is why we need to have that connection with the king and a sense of feeling. Let me tell you this. We celebrate the Holy Ghost and move of Holy Ghost when we shout and praise God. And let us do that. Don't stop that. That's wonderful, glorifying God, recognizing his presence. But let me tell you also, a spiritual move of God can be a hypersensitivity toward a particular need that you become an intercessor and begin to pray over it before you get on Facebook about it. You know what? Like I did that. I can't do that. I can't. And some people type up like that all that. You're really good at it. I do this. Sometimes my finger's too fat. Then I have to do personal spell check when I send something out. How many here know what I'm talking about? I feel like, who's in charge here? His phone or me? You know, fix my mistakes, but don't suddenly talk for me. And you know, sometimes realize the language of the world can be really offensive sometimes. I'm going to tell you some of the stuff that's come up on my spell check. I'm like, where did you learn how to say that? Wasn't for me. Been programmed for that. Forget that. Okay, now let's get back to something. Okay, thank you for your patience. But the sensitivity, being moved by God with the word, lining yourself up with the Lord that God will put a burden upon you. Some of us, we don't do anything because we ain't got no burden. We got our problems, but we ain't got this spiritual burden. Or somebody else or something else. Somebody say amen. We're so captivated in what's going on in our life that we're not brokenhearted about the other things that are going on in other people's lives. So I want to challenge you, before you get on Facebook and start announcing some tragedy, seek the face of God. Say, God, I feel moved about this. I want to talk about it. I want to talk to you about it. And I want you to talk to me about it. And we'll go from there. Can I get an amen out? This is good, hard stuff, but it's good. Little crystal in that seek his face so he might commune with you, get close to you, you get close to him. But I will tell you, if you don't feel a burden or wound over people, maybe perhaps you need to get close to God because you're insensitive. Not sensitive to wounds. He said, Pastor, I got stuff up. Yeah, that's true. But we're going to be a great leader in the kingdom of God. It's got to be outward and not inward. It's got to be outward and not inward. God's kingdom. Praise the Lord. I believe I'm speaking to some great people today. I believe some great people in this house understand and see that God's speaking to you. And you know so much of God and sensitive to God so much that you're asking, okay, God, is it me? Is it me, Lord? Is it me? Now, when I count to three, I want you to shout out loud, amen. One, two, three.
Amen.
So I'm not trying to go ask for silence and frowns, okay? You're killing me up here. You're killing me up here. All right. So here is the king notices the condition. And the king begins to give what's needed. And begins to move on the scene. Now, if you're interested in doing a specific work in God's kingdom, ask God to give you the passion with weight.
Wow.
Passion with weight. Not the waiting W-A-I-T, but passion with the W-E-I-G-H-T, weight. That's what Nehemiah, what hit him was a weight. It was a burden of weight. A passion and a weight. A desire with a burden. That heaviness that he was experiencing actually was the chabad or the anointing of God. Upon him, to move on him, to pray, and to seek the Lord, because God wanted to change his countenance. So much the king recognized the changed countenance of Nehemiah. God's taking over here because this ain't in my notes, but God was changing his countenance. So it wasn't the ordinary Nehemiah, but Nehemiah who'd been up close with God. And so the king noticed that, what was going on in his face. And so here, Nehemiah, we find he goes to Jerusalem with the king's blessing and favor. Now, I want to throw this out to you, an interesting fact that I thought was interesting how God works. Listen, God's got a plan. He knows the pieces and what to do and how to do it and who to do it with and to use. It's interesting that 30 years earlier in Persia, where Nehemiah was, that Esther marries Artaxerxes' dad, who is Xerox. I just want to say that. Looks like Xerox. I want to say Xerox, but Xerxes' guy, because I can say Artaxerxes, but Xerxes, it just, you know, it's a lot of X's there, but it looks like Xerox. It really does. But here Esther marries, and you know the story of that, how God uses Esther for that point in time so that to save an entire nation. But what I want you to see is that at that time, 30 years later, probably Artaxerxes was being influenced by his stepmother about the Jewish people and suddenly did favor to the Jewish people for Jerusalem. You see how God works the pieces together? Well, there's Esther. The influence over her set time, of the love, the devotion that he said, well, I want to do something good for the Jewish people, Nehemiah. I want to do this. Because Esther was Jewish and came from Israel. So I want to do this. So God worked on the scene. God, let me tell you, God is working on the scene. I mean, you think you and I, we experience our one in these specific eventful moments? But these eventful moments in our life, they have tentacles that touch other moments and times and other people, and it reaches out and there's a connection there. God is working the pieces in your life. And he wants to not only use you, touch you, but you're going to influence somebody else. In Nehemiah, you're not just going to pray for the walls to be rebuilt in the city, but no, God's going to bring his favor and blessing upon the nation. Because it's going to touch not only your life, Nehemiah, and those living there, but the next generations that are going to be raised up. Now, we can go to our text. Are you ready for it? Nehemiah chapter 2. I'm going to read from the New International Version because I like the wording a little bit easier. You can see the picture. And it might read a little different on the screen when I'm reading, because I might have the old version that I read. So it's just, it'll sound about the same, so just work it out. Here we go. I went to Jerusalem, and after staying there 3 days, I set out during the night. This is Nehemiah talking with a few others, and I had not told anyone what my God had put in my heart to do for Jerusalem. There were no mounts with me except the one I was riding on. By night, I went through the valley gate toward the chapel well and the dung gate, examining the walls of Jerusalem, which had been broken down in its gates, which had been destroyed by fire. When I moved on toward the fountain gate and the king's pool, but there was not enough room for my mount to get through, so I went up to the valley by night, examining the wall. Finally, I turned back and re-entered through the valley gate. The officials did not know where I had gone or what I was doing, because as yet I had said nothing to the Jews or the priests or nobles or officials or any others who would be doing the work. Then I said to them, and I saw them, "You see the trouble we're in. Jerusalem lies in ruins, and its gates have been burned with fire. Come, let us rebuild the wall of Jerusalem, and we will no longer be in disgrace." I also told them about the gracious hand of my God on me, and what the king had said to me, they replied, "Let us start rebuilding." So they began this good work. If you read through Nehemiah, you find they actually finished it in record time. Record time. They got the walls rebuilt and the gates hung. You know, I wonder, how did this small group of people be able to do such in spite of opposition, be able to accomplish this incredible task of rebuilding the wall? I'll tell you why. They started with a why. Nehemiah arrives after inspecting the walls, and he looks at old walls and looks and sees what's going on. He's ready to share his vision, passion with the leaders. And he said to them, he said, "You see the trouble we're in Jerusalem, lies in ruins, and the gates have been burned with fire. Come, let us rebuild the wall of Jerusalem, and we will no longer be in disgrace." And I also told them about the gracious hand of my God on me, what the king has said to me. I repeated that on purpose so you can hear it. Let me tell you what wasn't the why. What wasn't the why when he went before them? He didn't say, "Come, let us rebuild the wall and we will no longer be in danger." He didn't say, "Come, let us rebuild the wall and we will keep out foreign people." He didn't say, "Come, let's rebuild the wall and our economy will improve." He didn't say, "Come, let's rebuild the wall and we will make a name for ourselves," which is dangerous. He knew about the Tower of Babel. That's dangerous. Make a name for yourself. He didn't say that. That wasn't his why. And his why wasn't that. He didn't say, "Come, let's rebuild the wall and God will approve of us." No, Nehemiah wasn't motivated by safety, security, finances, nationalism, or selfish ambition. He said, "Come, let us rebuild the wall that we will no longer be in disgrace." Disgrace is the same word for shame and reproach. And the people worked, you see, they worked for the glory of God from beginning to end. The glory, the word glory, is defined as something that is a source of honor, fame, and admiration, a state of great splendor and magnificence or prosperity. This is not the plan of God. In other words, he's saying this isn't the plan of God for his people. To be in disgrace. For in essence, he was saying, but our God is glorious. This is not the plan of God. The Bible says in Psalm 72 and 19, "And blessed be his glorious name forever. And let the whole earth be filled with his glory. Amen, amen." He said that we will no longer be in disgrace. This isn't the plan of God for his people. He is glorious. And so that will be what his people will be, is glorious. If we fail, it's not the plan of God that we fail. It's not the plan of God that we advertise and promote the dissension and disgrace. It's not the plan of God to burn us up and tear down the walls. It's not the plan of God. Why? Because God is glorious, and therefore his people shall be glorious also. Because what comes from him goes to us. His glory flows down to us. And he looked at the people and said, listen, we are the people of God. We're the nation of God. This is the city of the Lord. This is the holy city of God Almighty. And God is glorious. Therefore, let us not live in disgrace, but let us be glorious, because our God is glorious. He found the why. His work is honorable, glorious, and his righteousness endures forever. Psalm 145, 5 and 12. I will meditate on the glorious splendor of your majesty and on your wondrous works to make known the sons of men his mighty acts and his glorious majesty of his kingdom. Paul writes in Corinthians, 1 Corinthians 10:31, whatever you do, do it all for the glory. Whatever you, there may be some walls that need to be rebuilt and some gates that need to be replanted. And you may have to get busy and get going with that, but whatever you got to do, whatever task you have, let it be for the glory of God. And if you do things for the glory of God, guess what happens? Then God lifts us up and he blesses us. In Psalm 3:3 says, but you, O Lord, are a shield for me. My glory and the one who lifts up my head. Oh, we've lived those moments in our lives where our head had to hang low. Because we had failed and we were sinful. We were rebellious. We were ungodly people. You know what I'm talking about. How many of you know what I'm talking about anyway? You know where you used to be. You know the bad self of you. You know how hungry and how ungodly you were and how lost you were and what a disgrace you brought to any possibility of God. But God says, no, I died on the cross for you. Jesus said, I love you, and I'm not here to put you down. I'm here to lift you up. I'm here for my glory to flow on you so that you'll be a glorious people and my name be lifted up. Why? Because God says, it's not a matter of my pride. It's not about my ability. He said, it's just for my name's sake, you're going to be glorious. And the devil knows it. That's why he uses you. That's why he puts you down. Because you've been made for the glory of God. And everything we do, let it be for God's glory. And the people work for the glory of God from beginning to end. From the beginning, that was the why. You must have. That was their why. And after you know your why, your reason, your purpose, then you have the next thing to face your why. What you need to do. Nehemiah confronted the brutal facts and always believed God would grant him success. Now, there was a difference in looking at stuff and then giving up, and then start declaring a bad prognosis. If I have a doctor come to tell me that I have cancer, and he don't seem to want to talk any hope at all, I mean, it can't happen, but I say it's time. I got a worn-out doctor. I need to find out someone that might believe there's a possibility in life. That might even be willing to fight a little bit for me. You know what I mean? To just give up. And Nehemiah, he faced the facts. But he said, but the mighty hand of God is on me, and success is going to happen. He said, he come by and told him everything bad. He wasn't an unrealist here. He was real. He was true. He spoke the truth. It was a mess. He gave an estimate of everything and what is. But he said, but my God, who has given us favor, God's going to. He didn't get into this thinking he wasn't going to be successful. He just looked at the situation, and in the name of the Lord, those walls are going to go back up, and the gates are going to be rebuilt, and the whole situation is going to be solved, because
could possibly, let me say, I'm going to add one way, who could possibly even imagine or think or even dare say that they can come against me, amen, and God be for us. Who can be against us? They who be against us. The one who's already been judged, already been sentenced, and he's a liar. And he's a liar. He wants us to feel like we're nothing but fit. You ain't gonna amount to much. But in Jesus' name, God has made him a glorious church and a glorious people. Yes. The walls may be down right now in your life, but because of the Lord, you can rebuild them. Be realistic of your failures. You'll never come to true repentance unless you're realistic. Did you know that? You'll never come to a place of forgiveness or repentance until you admit the fact that you're committed to sin. Unless you admit the fact that you're addicted to pornography. Until when you admit the fact that you drink and you shouldn't drink. Until you admit the fact that you have a filthy mouth and you say things you shouldn't. Until you admit, go and look at those broken down walls and burnt up gates, but then also declare, in the name of the Lord, these gates are going to be built and the walls are going up, and I'm not going to be the same anymore, because God has created me that I bring glory to him, and everything I do, I'm going to bring glory to God. Do you know how we fail to bring glory to God? We start listening to what the world is preaching and start going along with that song. Start speaking the word of God, learning the scripture, declaring and speaking it, then it becomes your worldview. We need to establish a biblical worldview. God's people need to be taught, and God's people need to study to show ourselves approved, a man that won't be embarrassed with the world. Because we got something to say. We do have something to say. Let everything we do, let it be to the glory of God. You go to work tomorrow, let it be for the glory of God. You got to go to work and face Hell's Kitchen. How many of you have ever worked in Hell's Kitchen? Raise your hand. How many are still working in Hell's Kitchen? Okay. I'm not talking about feelings. I'm talking about attacks that you face in opposition. You'll go in there in the name of the Lord. Go do that job in the name of Jesus Christ. You let your light so shine before men that people glorify your Father, which is in heaven. You go and you take it to your mission field. You're going to go and share Christ. You're going to witness. You're going to let your light shine. How many of you believe God gives us the power to do that? How many of you believe that when you're saved, you get the Holy Spirit to regenerate you? How many of you believe that God will baptize you in the Holy Ghost and give you power from on high so that you might be a witness? What I'm saying, yeah, be realistic. Be honest where you're at. God can do something with that. Quit blaming it somebody else. Quit accusing your family. Quit blaming a boss or a neighbor. Quit blaming this or that. Quit blaming the blame. The blame game didn't work in the garden. And it's not going to work now. Okay? Adam accused his Eve. Eve turned around and there was a handy snake who was guilty. It was the serpent's fault that did it. Then the serpent turned around and realized he didn't have a leg to stand on. That's a dad joke. You never know what's going on up here. I'm telling you. If you only knew, I'm glad it's not on the screen. It'd just be, oh, this crazy. But if the blame game doesn't work, God doesn't even really want you to blame and shame yourself. He wants you to confess to him as a heavenly father. I remember when I was in the second grade. There are times that, you know, the silliest things became incredible events and tragedy in my life. I didn't do my homework and had no school.
that I realized that my parents wouldn't be happy, but they would kill me. And I realized that when I confessed, then a weight was lifted. Like I knew then I had the strength of my parents to go with me into the school with a note. Ronnie forgot to do his homework. Please understand, he'll do it tomorrow, maybe do it. And I'll blah, blah, you know, sign, Mom. And Mom, that's really a word, is shh. I don't know about your mom, but you just had to know mine. The principal school knew my mom, you know. Everybody in the neighborhood knew my mom, and my mom was only 4'10". But she, I'm telling you why. Now, I don't think she was a firecracker. I think she was a stick of dynamite. I see what she can do. You have seen what your God can do. Look what the Lord has done with you and in you and changed your life. And if you know that you're not perfect and you've committed sin, confess to the Father will receive you. He'll forgive you, and he won't wag his finger and say, shame on you. He'll say, come on over here and let me give you a hug. And let me tell you not to do it anymore, but you got power through God and the Holy Spirit that everything you do, let it be for the glory of God. Demons are trembling this morning because there are saints who are realizing if they'll apply everything in their life to the glory of God, then they'll have God's anointing, God's favor, God's blessing upon them. Do it all unto the Lord. Ain't nobody love you more. I've got to finish here. He confronted the brutal facts, but he always believed God would grant them success no matter what. Believe your God is out to grant success in your life, blessing, favor in your life. But you're a child of God. You're the glorious child of God. God's love for you is more than the love of a grandparent has for a grandkids. Don't get me going there, okay? Don't get me started. I can talk to strangers out in the world, out in a store, bring up grandkids, and suddenly I got a million things to say. Because of my passion, my love. Your Father has passion for you. He's not ignoring you. He loves you. And everything you do, let it be for his glory. And God the Father will say, I will give you my glory. The first job of a good leader is to define reality. He saw the walls. He talked to them about it, how bad it was. He said, guys, listen, our walls are in ruins. Gates all over, but God will grant us success. Why? Because the people work for the glory of God from beginning to end. Work for glory to God to the beginning of end. And then also, success occurred because there was a diverse group of people willing to do something about it. That's the church. The church is willing to do something about it. The church unified. I've been to some churches, all they want what's in for themselves. They don't get to sing, then they're upset. Yeah. Pastor doesn't come by and talk to me, then he doesn't care I'm here. It's all this self-serving thing, and listen, hey, that our culture's creating that. I don't know, we just need the Holy Ghost, that's all I can say. We need the Holy Ghost. We don't want to grab a hold of the spirit of the age and of the world. But there's a diverse coalition of people who sacrificially work together for the glory of God. How did they do it? How did they rebuild it? Well, first of all, it begins with the priest. They end up doing, if you look at chapter 3, they end up doing a section of the law dedicated to God. Then there's the men of Jericho and the men of Tekoa. These are cities outside of Jerusalem. But they saw the value of Jerusalem and the value of the situation, and they jumped in to do something too. See, when a church wants to do something, then the community around us, and if it's going to value and benefit the community, they'll jump in and want to be a part of it. That a church could be able to move. God, that even unbelievers will start doing things for the church because they're being drawn to a purpose and to a why. And they see the why, the people are demonstrating that why. Let this church draw in the sinners. I mean, let us draw in the sinners. You You need to have dinner with a sinner and pay for it. Pay for it. And open up the kingdom to them, the kingdom of God. Do that, God will bless you. But see, the priests, they did a section. The men of Jericho, Tekoa, they jumped in, and their families that you know, to make this thing happen. And then there was a diversity that we also find in verse 8, that there were people from the guilds, the skilled people, blue-collar workers, and goldsmiths, and perfume makers. They began to build the wall and the gates and repair the gates. Then there's, in verse 12, we see that there's a ruler with his daughter that suddenly jumped in and said, okay, we can do our part, we can do this, and make this happen, because we discovered the why of why this has to be, because let the shame be removed, the disgrace be removed. Jesus bore our shame. He bore our disgrace on the cross, having it nailed there on the cross. And therefore, now we can live in the new life in Christ. Let everything we do, let it be for the glory of God. We have the Levites, the tribe of Israel, associated with the work of the temple. They did the work there. See, I'm talking about diversity, diverse crowd. And I stand in opposition to those in the world that want to say, there's just not enough diversity in the church. Well, let me tell you, the church was founded on diversity. There were people who came in from all around on the day of Pentecost. And they accepted the Lord and the gospel, and talking to all these people around. Then we spread it more diverse and started going to Gentile nations among Gentile people. So the Church of Jesus Christ has always had diversity. I'm looking at you right now, and I see quite a few diverse kind of people, you know. Oh yeah, you live around here, but you don't act like it all the time. You're kind of brought in where you came from. And that diverse people. But God can do great things. Then there's, and lastly, there's a group of, there's references of regular folks who started repairing a section of, next to their own house. So here's these people rebuilding. They saw the why, they saw the purpose and the reason. They saw the what, because somebody had a vision and said, you know what? God has given us favor, and we don't have to live in this disgrace. We serve a great God, and therefore we're not supposed to be a disgrace. We won't be, because we serve a great God. God will not fail you. He will not fail you. And the glorious one that he is will cause that glory to flow into you. You need to know your why. Look at the why, and you'll find that the how will begin to happen. God will make a way in your life. Now, that can be applied to churches. That can be applied to your personal life. Be a realist. See where you're at. Examine where you are. See if you can give the faith like Paul said. And God will help you begin to rebuild and change. But first of all, you've got to get a hard task. You've got to ride around on this broken down walls. Say, Lord, this all I'm being, you not call me to disgrace. You call me to your glory. And go through you, God, you'll bring me out. Bring me out. Just stand with me and worship me. God. I don't know where you're at. I don't. Nobody's been contacting me about any type of failure. A moment. I felt led of the Holy Ghost to share this with you to find your why. But you know that whatever you do, let it be with the Lord God. And this reconstruction God's going to do in your life, you all, it's all for the Lord God. That's the why. That's the why. You want to bring glory to God. I've heard people pray for many years. People would pray in times of conviction. Maybe we can have the altar and say, you know, don't want to bring the name of the Lord down. I want to be pleasing to God. I want to please Him. Now let me tell you, God won't love you any more than what He loves you right now. God wants to bring into your life. The Bible says in heaven that tears we wipe from the eyes and dry. You ever heard that said before? Tears of grief, everything. You can maybe define maybe what causes the tears in heaven. Somehow I feel there will be a group of people that will have tears in heaven seeing for the first time how things really could have been different if they just let God have his way in their life. And they see the missed opportunities God has given to us to receive his glory. I know that's serious stuff. We serve a great God. And God says, I don't want to withhold anything from you. I want to bless you. That's what God wants to do. He looks at you and you know what he sees? What he wants to say. He won't say, you have been doing this. No, he looks at you and says, I want to give you my glory. I want you to receive my glory. Because he's a wonderful God. He's great. He is. I wish I was just part of a man that'd be so much like him as a father. He's a great God. How many of you knows he's great? He's wonderful. How many knows what it is to be despicable? Deplorable. But yet God looked at you and said, no, you're lovely. You're wonderful. I can do so much with you and I will. That's our God. That's our God. How many are saved this morning? Say, Pastor, I don't want to be in disgrace. I want to live in disgrace and defeat. But I believe the Lord is going to give me his glory. I'm going to do everything in his glory for his glory. Just raise your hand for him. Now, hands are raised all over. Let me ask you this one more question as you leave your hands up. How many here say this morning, say, Pastor, I need some sins, my sins forgiven. I want you just real quick and just give it away. Just give it away. God bless you. God bless you. Now that's as simple as the Lord will forgive you, cleanse you, set you free. Do everything you do in the glory of God. Get on the computer for the glory of God. Give God everything in your life. Give God your communication, your talk, let it be for the glory of God. Edify the name of the Lord and one another. Amen. 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 Pray this prayer with me, everybody here. Especially you who get away. Say this prayer. Everybody pray with me. Heavenly Father, forgive me of my sins. I don't want to live in disgrace. But I want to live in your glory. Take over me right now. Be Lord of my life. And whatever I do, Lord, I want to bring glory to you. All the glory to you. In Jesus' name. I feel the Holy Ghost. Will you just lift your hands all over? Let's just worship and worship it. Lord, we glorify you. We praise you. Praise you, Lord. We praise you. Blessed be your name, O Lord. All glory and honor and praise. according to that scripture and that principle, in the name of the Lord, be lifted.